and as he said, he's one of the architects for the Growth Matters campaign. So I'll turn it over to Steve.
Thank you very much, Will. And I'd just like to start by saying what a great honour it is to be sharing the stage with two men I greatly admire and respect, and the Minister for Finance, Roy McTaggart, and the President of our Chamber, Mr. Paul Biles. And also how delighted I was when they came up with the idea for this forum. I know many people in the room would have been excited when they announced the Caboo lineup, but for me, that's not my Caboo. I'm actually hoping that we can persuade the DART and the other organisations involved to combine them for next year, and maybe we could call it Cabinomics or something like that. We've already got our first comedy act. And the numbers that the Minister of Finance presented were very encouraging, and I think the government deserves an awful lot of credit for the way it's run the economy in the last 5 years or thereabouts. And I wanted to just put the first question to Roy and ask, do you mind if I call you Roy? Okay. Right, you do. I prefer that. We could go back. And just to ask you to give us a brief summary of how important fiscal stability is for the country. How important do you see fiscal stability?
I think it's one of the key drivers of the economic growth that we are seeing. In an economy where you don't have that fiscal stability, and you have a government that's having to constantly raise revenues and taxes people, that constrains economic activity in a very big way. And I think it is so important that a government ought to exercise, the fiscal affairs of a country in a way that it promotes development, because that's what's going to help drive growth. And in order for a country to succeed, I firmly believe you've got to have economic growth. You're a dying country.
Absolutely. And Paul, I know we've got a lot of fans of fiscal stability in the room today, but outside of this room, how would you persuade the man on the street to care about this? What difference does it make to him?
Well, I think it's critical, really. I was give you an example. Ken Jefferson is sitting here, and you'll remember this, but international investors look at the country, and they use different measures to see whether it's a good place to do business. When the government of the day was trying to raise the $300 million, the bond issue that they're now going to pay off, thankfully, in a couple of years, they had to do a tour of several countries around the world, Singapore, lots of places. And one of the key parts of that presentation was the fiscal situation. So are we going to lend money to this country, invest in their paper, their instruments? The question is, can they afford to repay it? And when they ask that question, can they afford to repay it, they're looking at things like the presentation you just made, all of those numbers. Can they really afford it? What's their fiscal strategy? Are they responsible? What's their history, right? And so on. I think it's very important from that perspective. So the guy in the street is very important for another reason. If a government is fiscally unstable, chances are it's going to be very unpredictable. You're going to face taxes. And when I say taxes, I mean the taxes that we all know that we do pay. The world thinks we don't pay taxes, but we all do. And we pay a lot of indirect taxes, whether it's the fees or your driver's license or whatever, your business license. Everything costs something in this country. And so they will keep raising those fees. If they're fiscally irresponsible, they will raise the fees so they can balance the budget every year. And in the past, we've had years where I know industry have said, I just think this year it's going to be the same thing again. They're just going to raise the fees again to make the budget balance. And then they don't spend the funds properly, and then they end up in a situation again where they have to raise the fees again so the budget could balance. I haven't seen that for many years. I'm very thankful to see that we've stabilized the country in that way. But that's why it's important to us ordinary people that we have fiscal stability. The last one is the debt. The debt that we spoke to there, they look like interesting numbers, they look like ratios, and they may not mean anything to us, but they mean a lot to us because we actually pay the debt. He doesn't pay the debt, I can tell you, right? We pay the debt because we pay the taxes to generate the revenues so the debt can be repaid. And I think it's very important for us to see the debt going down. And in fact, what really strikes me, I know you guys might not know it, and I'm not a nerd or anything, but I happen to know something I'm going to say now. The debt to GDP ratio is 14 2017. In the US, that ratio is now over 100%, it's 107% to be exact. If you use the IMF measure, it's 107. If you use another measure, it's 90%, right? In the UK, it's 87%, right? So we're talking serious debt. Many countries in the Caribbean have a debt ratio of between 30 and 68%, right? So having a 14% ratio is extraordinary, frankly. And to be able to have a ratio like that, while for X number of years not raising the taxes, the indirect taxes, is a, that's why the Quran is why she said it's a well-run economy, because she's looking at the numbers. And so the numbers tell us a lot in that respect, as, at least compared to other countries.
So Ryan, why is it so important for us to keep our debt to GDP so much lower than the United States or the UK?
Well, a lower debt to GDP ratio really gives you, certainly, you look at it, would indicate it's indicative of the ability of a country to service that debt. And the higher that number gets, you know that it is going to become more and more difficult, because it would require more resources of the government revenues that they collect in order to service that debt. And that's just paying off the, you know, basically the sins of the past, whatever that might be. So the lower you can keep it, I'd like to see the zero actually. And given a second chance, I would certainly be trying to get there.
Okay, well.
But it is critical, really, because it can saddle a country down. And I mean, you know, he mentioned that the GDP of the US, at some point, they have to come to terms with it. And otherwise, it's, you know, the debt burden, the repayment obligation is going to start to affect the ability of a country to provide the other services that
they do fund. Yeah. I want to share with you some numbers that I went through this morning. This is the kind of thing I do for fun. As most of you know, I'm a recovering, like my good friend Roy, I'm a recovering accountant. I can't help myself going through the numbers. And we've got pretty healthy operating surpluses, and we have had for 7 years, but there are some numbers that aren't included in operating surplus. Capital expenditure, which you pointed out, interest, and the surplus or loss from the statutory authorities. There's one other big one that I'll come back to. But if you look, I want to focus just on the numbers for 2018 and the operating surplus that's projected for 2018, that's this current fiscal year, is $111 million. Capital expenditure of $94 million, interest of $24 million, and then the loss from statutory authorities of $6 million. So once all those things are factored in, that does still come to a negative number of $13 million. The same number for, unless my numbers are wrong, which they could well be, it wouldn't be the first time that Roy's corrected my numbers. Does that sound correct?
That negative number bothers me in terms of...
So if you take the operating surplus of $111 million, then capital expenditure of $94, then interest of $24, okay, and the loss from statutory authorities of $6 million. So that comes to an overall loss in cash terms of $13 million. This on the same basis number for next year is $40 million. And those numbers don't include another big thing that I wanted to touch on next, which is the unfunded healthcare liability. So those numbers don't include the movement in that big liability. And that liability between the years of 2014 and 2016 increased by $500 million. So the first question I have is, why? Can you give us some insight as to why that unfunded healthcare liability increased by $500 million in 2 years?
The only explanation I can give you is that that's what was actuarially determined.
Yeah.
2014 was the first year it had ever been, quantified. Or that. And
do you have a sense of how quickly that's growing? That was $250 million a year. I think in that report, in the 2016 report, they said that it.
I think the most recent one that we had, if I recall, best you might correct me, but it actually showed a decline of $100 million for the year, the movement. So yes,
so that's encouraging.
Well. So. Still a large number, either way you look at it.
Yeah.
And it's something new to the country. We have to well.
Yeah.
Well, at the moment, we're funding those liabilities on a pay-as-you-go basis.
Yeah.
And that's costing us some $50 million a year.
So what is the plan to get that unfunded liability under control?
A number of things have been looked at. I can say, and I know that within the portfolio of civil services, they have a number of, I think it's what I can only describe to you as a smorgasbord of issues or potential solutions. We're working through those potential solutions with a view to trying to identify what made the most sense. And it's still a big work in progress. I can't tell you we'll have a solution in the next month or 6 months, but it is one that the ministries and the government is, one, very concerned about, and secondly, working to try and actively identify what the right solutions are.
Well, can you touch on the Chamber's efforts to help the government try and bridge this gap?
Efforts and Chamber point of view, I think we had meetings recently, as you would be aware, talking about getting a committee together to look at the issue itself. I think you were right to raise it, and we had a group that we're going to look at. So I think I don't think it's insurmountable, but I don't think it's also a unique issue. I think it's something that exists all over the world. I think you have lots of situations where this generation is paying for what's going to happen next for the next generation. And you also have many countries who did not make the decision to set funds up, for example, pension funds and so on, until very late in the history of their country. And so, of course, there's no way that they have enough contributions and pension to take care of people going forward. And they made that decision recently. They didn't make the decision 300 years ago because they just didn't think of it then. We made ours not so long ago, actually, as a country. How many years is it our pension? So only a couple of decades ago. So of course you're gonna have that issue, and you're gonna have to find a way to, I think ride through that issue. But it's not gonna be easy because we start in a position where we're clearly not gonna have enough contributions to take care of the next. Right. That said, we have been going for 20 years with that issue on our backs. So somehow the number of people that need support are getting enough support somehow for it to work. But I do think it's an issue that will come to a head at some point.
But what I would say to you, and what we are starting to see, is that as people retire and realize that they don't have sufficient funding to satisfy the people that they're here, we're finding that they're exhausting their pension funds reasonably quickly. And in the absence of any other source of money, it's like they are turning to government and to the Ministry of Community Services for assistance.
It's actually a very important point that in many countries they have a very formal welfare system, a very formal structure that you don't have a job and you need some support, so you go to an office and you get a check for $400 because you don't have a job. We don't have quite a system like that, but we do have social support, and we have to have social support. In every country you have to have that. We just don't have it formalized. For example, I don't tax you 5% of your income so that I can take care of his grandparents.
I can't afford that too much.
That's right. But the point is that we don't have a formal system like that, so we still have to find ways to do it. So when you see, for example, the NAU department and the struggles that they have, that is just a small attempt at trying to deal with the vulnerable and those that fall through the cracks. But the vulnerable and those that fall through the cracks exist in every country. It's just that they have a formal institutional approach in many countries to take care of those people. And I don't know if we're ever going to get to a stage where we have to do anything differently because we don't have a direct taxation system. So what we're currently doing is we have a budget, and in that budget, the government allocates a certain amount for, to take care of social welfare. Social welfare isn't, it's not anybody's, it's not a problem. It's something that occurs everywhere. And no matter how successful an economy you are, no matter how great your policies are, you're always going to have a small percentage of vulnerable, unprivileged people that need support, right? And that's just the nature of how the economy works. So I think we just have to find a better way to do it. But the point I'm making is that let's not pretend that we don't have social support, because we have it, right? We have welfare, a welfare system that's not very formalized, but we have to support it. One of those that we have to spend those.
Yeah, absolutely. If there's one thing I know about surplus, it's that it equals revenue minus expenses. I remember you talking about that back in the day, Roy. So I want to talk, rather than just talking about the surplus in terms as if the government can control the surplus, really the government can control the surplus, they can control the revenue to an extent and the expenditure, and that together equals the surplus or deficit. And one thing that strikes me, a big difference between public sector accounting and private sector accounting, is that in the private sector, companies spend money on their expenses in order to generate the revenue, and hopefully you generate more revenue than you spend in expenses. Doesn't always work out. And the public sector is not really like that, right? For government, they are trying to decide how much money they can raise without damaging the economy. They're trying to decide how much money to spend. And so these things are very separate. How concerned are you about our sources of revenue? Because the other thing that strikes me is that our expenditure is pretty fixed. It's very difficult to get to move the dial on expenditure, and it does tend to rise over time. Whereas the revenue is more cyclical, especially with the dependence we have on the three main industries of construction, tourism, and financial services. How concerned are you, especially in the light of the events of the last week, how concerned are you about the cyclical nature of our revenue and that may dip in the future?
Well, of course it is of concern, because when you start to see your revenues contract, it doesn't take too long before you start approaching that flat line and get into a situation and get into the negative numbers. I haven't been as concerned in recent years because of the performance that we have been seeing in all the revenues, and we've had a sustained period now of positive growth across every sort of revenue stream that we have. But I'm also mindful of the fact that everything I start to read now in financial journals and economic articles, that
I don't see the B word.
It's time for one.
Right.
And that does concern me, although I have to say I just don't see very many signs that something is happening or likely to happen on this horizon. All the indicators that we see are very positive in terms of continuing growth. You have the unpredictability clearly of Mr. Trump, and you know, you see one statement he makes one today, and you see what it did to the stock market when he said he was going to be backed out of the meeting with North Korean leader. Those things tend to have an impact on your economy, but it tends to be very short-lived. And I think, by and large, the U.S. economy, which we look to primarily, looks set to continue growth for at least the next 2 to 3 years. I just don't see any signs of a recession or depression coming on here. And you know, I've always believed that when the U.S. sneezes, came and catches a cold. I mean, 80%, 84% of our imports come from the United States. 80% of our tourism comes from the United States. 80% of our financial services business comes from the United States. And so we are, whether we like it or not, we're inextricably linked to that economy and to that country.
Yeah, I think we have a very interesting situation in the country, in that we are one of very few countries in the world that relies almost exclusively on a set of indirect taxes. There are not many countries in the world left that have this kind of system. But that kind of system has pros and it has cons, right? And as a country, I think we're dealing with the cons, because overall it's still good for us. And the con is that we import most of our goods, and therefore, if we're going to have consumption-based taxes, the cost of living is high. Right? We already know it's a very high cost of living to live in this country, right? We've accepted that because, on balance, the nature of the regime benefits the overall economy. So for example, I feel better knowing that when I make whatever I make, that nobody's taking a percentage out of that, my check. I prefer to work that way. I don't like the idea that you will take $20 for every $100 that I make as a government, right? I feel like I have some kind of freedom and to make my own decisions. And my own decisions is, what am I going to spend today? And based on that, that is how much tax I will pay. So I feel like I have some control. Now, I think as citizens and residents, we all like this. So that's one of the benefits as well. It also is a benefit, I guess, in terms of financial services, because people pay their taxes back home, but they don't get two layers of taxes. So we don't have the corporate tax. But people, obviously, all investors that invest in the country through any vehicle get taxed when the funds go back to them anyway. So that's, we know this is a story. That's not what the media says, but that's the true story. But we do avoid at least that extra layer on the corporate vehicle tax. And so I think it provides benefits. I worry that, I don't know if over time if that will catch up on us. It will be so expensive to live here that we start questioning the nature of the regime. I hope that never happens, because I personally don't want to see the regime change, actually. But it's something that we have to think about, because consumption taxes, by their very nature, they can also be very regressive, and those who don't have high incomes, they get hit a lot by the consumption that they have to make, because they have to buy something. It's not complete freedom. You can't say, I'm not buying any goods today, because you have to live, so you have to buy something. And therefore, it does impact your budget disproportionately when you're lower income as well. And I don't know if there's anything we can do in the country to try to fix that, but that is a concern that I have.
If I could just touch on one of the things you asked about, particularly with the events of last week. And I'd have to say that, you know, so far it looks like Cayman is just taking this in its stride. And we've not seen any evidence at this point, anecdotal or otherwise, of any significant downturn or any downturn in business activity and financial services. That's the situation as it is.
Do you think that's because it's unlikely that the public register of beneficial owners will ever be forced upon us, or do you think it's that the industry has a concern?
Well, how it does. My view is that it is now law, and so unless we do it ourselves, which we don't intend to, that UK House of Lords will issue the order in council. Now, I say that, but I predicate my statement in saying that I think we still have some uncertainties whether who will be in power in 2020 when that all comes. But my belief is that we will receive that order in council in all overseas territories. Yeah.
I think the presumption as well that makes you start to wonder if it's going to be good or bad is this idea out there that a lot of people are going to be concerned. Well, people are going to be concerned if there are some major issues, right? So there are two baskets, there are two groups of two categories of clients when you think about it. So there's a category of clients that are just doing regular business and they have no issue with their information being known. There's certainly that category. And then there may be a category of clients that are in a similar situation, but they just don't like the idea of invasion of privacy, right? So they're not doing anything wrong, but they feel like their financial privacy is a legitimate thing. They want to have that. And as a result of that, they may feel uncomfortable with the idea that everyone in this room could have all their information. And I think, as a jurisdiction, I'm more concerned about that group, not because they're doing anything wrong, but just because they have a legitimate concern about privacy. And as a result, they may say, I'm not sure I want to do business there because I want to go to a place where at least my information isn't available to John Smith on the road. At the same time, I think the minister is right. I think the country is managing it very well in the short term so far, in that the message is it's business as usual. There hasn't been any change, actually, so no one has anything to worry about. And the premier has made it very, very clear that we're not going to accept the idea that it can be legislated upon us. So I think from that perspective, I don't think that there's an issue. The criticism that we've gotten so far that I think is not credible is the idea, is the third group of clients now, that we have people who are doing very bad things and therefore they don't want their information to be known or that to know their owners of these entities. And I think that's really the issue. We don't have, I don't believe we have a lot of those people anyway. And as a result, that's why there isn't a lot of concern. People aren't jumping up and running away because they're really bad. And the idea that if you don't have anything to hide, then you shouldn't worry, is also an incorrect approach. Because if the minister said that to me, I would say to the minister, can you please give me the balances in your bank account? And he would say, are you crazy? You just crossed the line. So it seems that everybody has a line beyond which they don't want to cross. So they may say, in the luxury of being in the UK or in the US or somewhere else and reading the newspapers and talking about islands and with palm trees, they will say, why should they worry? Because if they have nothing to hide, they should just open it. And then you say to the same person, can I please have your private information? They say, no, obviously not. So I think it's very hypocritical, but it's also it's luxurious of them to be able to say in the comfort of their own chair that we should all show our information anyway, when they won't do it themselves. The other issue we have is that throughout Europe, and not just Europe, but also everywhere else, there is a massive wave, and 7 years ago it started, of data protection legislation everywhere, right? And data protection is data protection. It's a very basic principle. So I'm not going to give my information to you unless I really have to, right? That's the essence of it, right? And it's private, and I have a legitimate right to privacy. So if we're saying that we want to have a system that helps to fight money laundering and all those things, then we're also saying that we would like for that information to be available to law enforcement agencies and authorities and so on. Those are the only people that need that information, right? And so what I see here is a push for the information to be public to everyone on the street. And then you have to think carefully about that. For whose benefit is that? There's two things. One, there's the idea that it would scare people off, the ones that are in the second basket that want legitimate privacy, right? And two, there's the media, right? So the media would love to be able to have this information, to have great stories that they can write, and they can put the correct phraseology, like alleged and not yet known, and do cute things to make stories sound very entertaining, but actually just penalizing people and destroying their reputations, but without going to court because they've put the language in the right way, but casting aspersions essentially. And so I know the media is fighting to have it done because the media wants more juice, more stories, but I don't think that's the right reason to do it. And certainly it goes against every basic principle of data protection. How can we say that we're introducing data protection now and then tomorrow is a deadline for the EU countries to do certain things and advising their clients? And we're seeing emails now. So how can we say that we have data protection that we're introducing, and at the same time say we actually don't care about the privacy of information? It makes no sense. So I don't see it lasting. I don't see it becoming a global standard, because a global standard means other countries have to do it.
I agree. What I would say though is I think we've got to the point where we have to draw that line. We came in, and other overseas offshore financial centers, we have been cajoled, we have been pushed up, going on pretty much 2 decades to relax things, provide more, be more open, more transparent. A lot of these things are really good, but what you see now is what the real aim of the whole process has been all along. Because every time we have complied or responded positively in one area, before you even finish off on doing it, you're on to the next thing. And you see the goalposts have moved. And we saw it unfold right here with these issues now with the UK. And we have an agreement with the UK that we would implement public registers when it became a global standard. Well, they just initiated that, they walked away from it, they cast it away. Why? For political expediency. No other reason.
All right. Time flies when you're talking about fiscal stability. I know. Before I throw it open to the floor, I'm hoping I heard a buzzer going off, which I'm assuming is someone's way of telling me to get shut up and get off the stage. But before I do, I just wanted to give our Minister of Finance an opportunity to end on a high note, if that's possible, in fiscal affairs. What do you see as the biggest opportunity? What do you see 10 years out for Cayman? What's going to be in store? And when are we going to finally have this debt paid off? You said you wanted to do it. Is that going to be within your next term in office or this one?
It would have to be the next term, because I don't think I can get it done by 2021. But certainly, I would love to see that happen for the government, for government and for our country, because I think it would do us, put us in such good stead and put the finances in the country in such a good position that a lot more can be done with the resources that we do have. But look casting myself forward and look in, I think that the future is bright. Tourism, there's no reason why it cannot continue to grow. We have, and we're addressing the issue of accommodation capacity with new facilities that are coming on. And I think for the first time since Hurricane Ivan, we brought it back to pre-Ivan levels of room stock. And so what we're adding on to it now will provide, can only enhance the product. So that industry, I think, is extremely well positioned to continue to grow. And financial services, I think financial services can be substantially different from where it is today. You've got the emerging fintech and all of those things that are going to play out in a very big way. And so, just like banking has gone from being the dominant part of financial services, it's just a relatively small portion. You're going to see the dynamic shift quite substantially over the next decade. And I think that we still need to keep our eyes on finding potential ways to diversify the economy. We always looked upon Helsinki as being that third element in terms of developing medical tourism. It's been very successful, and I think the future for them is extremely bright as well. So I think that by and large, the prognosis and the prospects for this country are exceedingly good. And we just need to manage things and make sure that we can deliver, that we're able to provide steady economic growth that is needed. What I don't want to see, Steve, is to get real spikes in growth that you can't manage. And I don't want to go back to the 80s or the early 90s when things were growing at 5-6%. And we were all screaming because the government couldn't keep up with the infrastructure needs and capacity. Right now, with a 3% growth rate, we can manage it quite well. And we can deal with all of those issues and continue to generate surpluses that will allow us to provide for the needs of the community, as well as repay our debt and take care of our people.
Fantastic. Well, do we have time for questions?
Yeah, one or two questions. Well, if there's no questions, any questions, just hold on to them. We have another panel discussion after coffee break, but
okay.
It's a great opportunity to ask the minister a question. I don't want you to do that often. I don't know. I see. All right. Here we go.
I want to put me up there. I mean, I just want to have a closing question. Floor, do the right thing. I was kind of wanting to say this for the financial segment because, as a layperson, not being in the financial services industry, but observing what's going on, knowing that our Minister of Financial Services is defending us in Europe right now, and harking back to something that she has said, all politics are local. And recognizing that the biggest threat we face at the moment is from the United Kingdom, I appreciate what you mentioned, that we're going to fight the imposition, if it comes to that, of an ordering council here for the United States. But what are we doing to fight to win the hearts and minds of the voting public in the United Kingdom? Because after all, that at the end of the day, is likely to be, on a long-term basis, the greatest determinant of what's going to happen in respect of not just this issue, but in respect of the relationship with Cayman Islands. If they don't see value in what Cayman Islands does, although we know the value of what it brings to the United Kingdom economy, the city of London, and so on, but if we're not reaching them, reaching their hearts and minds, it's concerning that we're not walking a short walk.
Tim, what I'll say is that over the past 4 to 5 years, we have made great progress in educating people in the UK with regard to what Cayman is, what we are about, and where we, where we see ourselves. And so their knowledge and appreciation is growing, but it is nowhere near what it needs to be. And, you know, there is clearly still that unappreciation for what Cayman really is and what we contribute and how we help, indeed, even business in the UK. Now, as far as challenges, we've had a preliminary opinion from our attorneys in our QCs in the UK, constitutional lawyers, that say that there are very solid grounds for a legal challenge to this forced, forced implementation of the beneficial ownership registers. There have been very few cases I could ever think of where the UK legislature, not the House of Lords, not an ordering council, but legislator directing a legislation be made for the country. And so time will only tell where this ends up. But we believe that we do have very strong and solid grounds to make a challenge to what is transpiring.
Thank you, Roy. Any other questions? No. In that case, I'll just thank the panel members very much. Please join me in thanking them.
So we'll then take a 10-minute coffee break, grab some coffee, and go on with another thing, and come back here and try to take